Hey Raw fans, welcome. In this video, we're going to look at the differences between switches with insulated frogs and switches with powered frogs. We'll look at the differences of the turnout and the wiring differences and why you may want to choose one over the other on your own layout. So come on in, let's have a look. All right, guys. Over here I've got a little test track set up where I can go ahead and test some switches with insulated frogs and some switches with powered frogs and look at the wiring differences in them. And I wanted to go ahead and do this because normally, or at least for the last several layouts I've built, I've always used switches that have insulated frogs. They work very well and I really like them a lot. But because this is going to be a switching layout and I'm going to have lots of engines with very short wheelbases, and they're going to be traveling at very slow speeds, sometimes the insulated frogs can give you a little bit of problems with that. So I wanted to go ahead and test out some of my engines, both with Electrofrog turnouts and insulated frog turnouts, and see what the differences were, and also look at the differences in wiring. So with that, the demonstration today, all the track I have is Peco Code 83 track. And then the first switch we're going to look at is the Insulfrog switch. But before we do that, I want to cover just very quickly a little bit of terminology so that you understand what I'm talking about when I say different things. The first off is the term switch. And when I say switch in here, I mean this piece of track. That's what I mean when I say switch. Some model railroaders call these turnouts. Perfectly fine. It kind of helps avoid confusion a little bit so that you know you're not referring to a switch, you know, like this. But I don't call them turnouts usually. I call them switches. So that's what this is. But now let's take a up-close look at the switch and look at a couple different parts on it so you understand the parts of it. Okay, for this example we have a insulated frog switch, and the first part I'll show you is the frog, which essentially is the area where the two rails would cross. And for model railroad switches, they sort of have the whole area called the frog. So that includes the wing rails, and then sort of all the way from the toe of the frog to the heel of the frog. That whole area is sort of called the frog, and that would be either insulated or electrified. Now you've also got the stock rails. You've got the switch points, which is the section of the switch that moves. You have the closure rails, which connect the switch points to the frog. And then the last piece that I'll sort of highlight is the guard rails, which are sort of opposite the frog, up next to the stock rails. So now let's go ahead and look at a close-up of the insulated frog here. And here you can see how they use plastic to sort of insulate it, in that the point of the frog, the two rails actually don't come together. They switch over to be plastic. And then there's some plastic down below the wing rails. And so that whole area in there ends up being insulated. Compare that now to this electrified frog switch, where you can see the wing rails are connected to the closure rails, and then the point of the frog is actually all metal where the two rails come together. So here, looking at the two different switches side by side, it's easy to see the insulated frog versus the electrified frog. Now looking at insulated frog switches a little bit closer, there's sort of two big categories of insulated frog switches: power routing and non-power routing. Now the insulated frog Peco Code 83 switches are power routing, and so what that means is that the power only travels through the switch in the direction the switch is thrown. And so if you're using these on a DC layout, they will go ahead and self-isolate the section that where the switch is not thrown to. So if you wanted to put a passing siding or something, it would automatically isolate it. Now with DCC, you don't really use this feature because you're going to end up having all your rails powered, so it doesn't really matter if you have a power routing or non-power routing switch. And speaking of how electrical power flows through the switch, let's go ahead and look at the differences now in how power goes through a insulated frog versus a powered frog switch. So here's an illustration of how power would flow through an insulated frog switch and a powered frog switch if the switches were thrown to the diverging route. And then in this illustration, you can see that the big difference is sort of that area over the frog. Whereas the powered frog, you can see there's a continuous amount of power that the wheel is going to be in contact with the entire way through the switch. Whereas when it's going through the insulated frog switch, there's going to be a gap there of anywhere from a half inch or longer, depending upon the frog length of the individual switch. So now if we go ahead and throw the switches, you can see how the power changes the way it transfers through the switch. And one item to note here with the way the power is routing here and stuff, both of these switches are unmodified out of the box. This is exactly how they come from the factory, and this is the way the power routes through them from the factory. And we'll go ahead and switch this back, and we'll change it a couple times here. So again, you can look at the differences as to how it changes depending upon the way the switch is thrown. Now, in addition to how they work directly from the factory, there is a built-in modification that you can make to the Electrofrog turnout that Peco already has built in. But before I explain how to do that modification, let me talk a little bit about why you might want to. And it has to do with your getting a short as your engine or a piece of equipment travels through your switch. Now, for Insulfrog switches, your primary culprit for a short would be where the two closure rails come together near the toe of the frog. In that area, those closure rails are of different polarity, and so if a wheel is out of gauge or if it's derailed or something, as it slides through the toe of the frog, it could end up contacting both closure rails, which would then cause a short. But other than that, an Insulfrog switch is pretty reliable and isn't going to give you any shorts. Now with Electrofrog turnouts, they have a potential for a short, but it's in a totally different area because all the area around the frog is the same polarity. But up at the switch point, the stock rail and the switch point are of opposite polarity on one side. And so again, if you have a wheel out of gauge or it's derailed, it can contact both the switch point and the stock rail as it goes through that opening. However, unlike the Insulfrog switches, the Electrofrog switches actually have a built-in fix for this that's really easy to do with a sort of a simple modification to the switch. And it will greatly reduce the possibility of getting a short when a piece of equipment goes through the switch. So what you can see here in the difference between option one and option two is the modified switch. And what that modification does is actually depowers the switch point and a portion of the closure rail so that if a wheel or something contacted both the switch point and the stock rail, it would not cause a short. So let's go ahead and look at how you can make this change on your Peco Electrofrog switches if you want to do so. If you look at the top of the switch, you can see the closure rails actually have a small gap cut into them, and then they're connected to one another from a small wire on the underside. And so the first step is going to be actually you need to cut that wire and go ahead and cut it in a couple spots to completely clear the wire out so that they're not accidentally going to touch each other at some point in the future. So here you can see what it looks like once those are completely cut out and isolated. Now the Electrofrog switches already come with a wire that powers the frog, and so then you end up just powering this wire, and then that will power the frog. However, this is where the sort of electrical side of the this option gets a little more complicated, because the frog actually has to change polarity as the switch is thrown. So in addition to changing the mechanical position of the switch, you have to change the electrical polarity of the frog. So in order to do that, you need some type of electrical switch attached to the mechanical switch, or something that will throw both of them at once or change both of them at once. Now there's a couple of different ways you can make this power change. Peco actually makes it pretty easy. They make an accessory switch that if you're going to use a Peco switch machine that attaches to their switches, then this attaches to the underside of the switch machine and will change the polarity of the frog for you. And so the way it works is the mechanical rod that actually moves back and forth that changes the position of the switch points actually inserts, it sticks down below the switch machine and inserts into this accessory switch. And so it changes it as well at the same time, which then will change the power of your frog. Because while you have both positive and negative coming into the switch machine, the position of that switch will then determine whether positive or negative is going to the frog. Okay, so here this is set up on my little test track. I've got one of the accessory switches. Now this one I'm just manually throwing. It's not hooked into a switch machine at all. But I've got positive and negative coming off the rails going into it. And then it's positioned, and I'm going to use this little pin to change it. As I change the switch, then I'll slide that over, and that just changed the polarity of the frog. And so now I have operation of a powered frog turnout without any possibility of shorting, because the switch point that's next to the opposite polarity of the stock rail is actually dead now. Now, the last thing I want to go ahead and cover in this video is the different ways you would power the switches, whether you're using an insulated frog switch or an electrofrog switch, and then the two different options there, option one or option two. Now, the big difference in wiring an electrofrog turnout versus an insulated frog turnout really is on the rails that come together to form the point of the frog. And on an electrofrog turnout, or one with a powered frog, you're going to want those to be connected with either insulated rail joiners or actually just have a gap. You don't want power coming in there, because those are electrically one piece. And so you have to have them isolated, and you have to allow them to change as one. And so you don't want to have power feeders or have it connected to your regular stock rail. That's a lot different than your Insulfrog switch, where you can go ahead and have metal joiners there or power feeders there, and it won't interfere with anything at all. And with Electrofrog, sort of option two there, where you have that one portion of the closure rail and the switch point isolated, you do have to have an electrical switch to change the polarity of the frog. But that's it for wiring these. I'm not going to make the whole video here about wiring. Certainly there's lots of different options and lots of different ways, and there's certainly a lot of books and videos that cover how to wire your layout. So I won't cover all that here. So back at the beginning of the video, I said I wanted to set up this little test track to test a bunch of my engines going through it. And interestingly enough, when I tested all of my small switch engines going through the Insulfrog switches, they actually all performed flawlessly going through the Insulfrog switches. I actually didn't see any difference in performance or sound or anything going through the Insulfrog switches versus the Electrofrog switches. Now, having said that, I don't currently own every engine I'm ever going to own. There are several small steam engines that I actually don't have right now, so I wasn't able to test those. And so there is the possibility that some engine I would own in the future might perform better on an Electrofrog switch over a Insulfrog switch. And so even though all of my current engines perform great on the Insulfrog switches, I think I will probably use Electrofrog switches on my new switching layout that I'm working on. And I'm probably going to go ahead and wire them with sort of that option two that I showed you in the video. Alright guys, well that's it for this video. Hopefully you liked it, hope you found it useful and interesting, and hopefully now you have the information available so that you can make the decision as to the type of switch that's right for your layout, ones with insulated frogs or ones with powered frogs. But with that, as always, make sure you keep running your trains, keep enjoying them, and we'll catch you at the next update.